praise the Lord today. Resurrection Sunday. Resurrection Sunday.
Amen.
There are some who question whether the resurrection actually happened. There are some people who question whether or not Jesus is in fact the Son of the living God. There are some today who question the existence of God. Some theologians have examined this over the years, and they have a question for the people with the question. And the question is, if you doubt that he is who he said he was, then please, ma'am, please, sir, explain to me the empty tomb.
Right.
If it's ever crossed your mind to question whether in fact he is who he said he was and can do what he said he would do from beginning to end, if you have doubts, please, ma'am, please, sir, explain to me the empty tomb. Here are the facts. They saw him die on the cross. And if there was any doubt about when the scripture says he bowed his head and gave up the ghost, those who were present testified to the fact that just in case he had passed out and not died, they took a spear from the ground up and jammed it up his ribcage straight through into his heart. So that blood and water came out of his body. If there was any doubt that after spending 3 hours hanging there with nails in his hands and nails in his feet after being scourged, if there was any doubt about whether he in fact died, the evidence is that they speared him just to prove a point. Fact one. He was dead. Fact two, they placed him into a tomb that was borrowed from a wealthy man who was secretly one of his disciples. Scripture says that to prove that he would stay there, the Romans chose, fact, to place sentries in front of the grave and to roll a stone that it took several men to place in front of. Why? Because they wanted to silence this man. They wanted to silence his followers. They wanted to put an end to his message. If he was not who he said he was, and if he is not able to do what he said he would do, please, ma'am, please, sir, explain the empty tomb. The scripture is clear that they placed his body into the tomb, and because it was the eve of the Sabbath, they did not have time to prepare his body with the normal fumes and ointments that they normally wash a dead man in. So they quickly wrapped him up and put him in the tomb. Fact. And now, on the next day, they hid themselves, and the scripture says, followers came to the place where he lay. And the documentation says he was nowhere to be found. because the Romans, they began to go through Jerusalem and all of those areas trying to find the body of this man Christ. It is documented. Here's the question. Explain the empty tomb. So theologians have said one of two things can have happened because the tomb was empty. One, the Romans could have taken the body. The tomb was empty. So I have to ask you a question, just as the theologians have. What motive did the Romans have after going through all the trouble to crucify him, to silence him, and they knew that the saying was that he would raise after 3 days? What motive would they have to validate that by taking the body themselves? They had none. You know, when they try to figure out who done it, who's the one who done it, the murder mysteries, the thing that they always look for, the police will tell you, motive. You may look like you're guilty just because you look guilty. Yeah, I'm looking at you. You look guilty. But the question is, did you have motive? One thing is opportunity, but if you don't have motive, it don't make sense. So what was the motive? The Romans had no motive. Scratch that. So the question then becomes, did his disciples take the body? Reasonable assumption. After all, they were the ones who wanted to continue his mission. They were the ones who wanted to continue the belief that the Messiah had come. They had all the motive. First question, how did they do it? The stone is in the way. There are guards on either side. The Bible answers that question for you. But let's suppose somehow they were able to drug the guards to make them fall asleep. Let's suppose for a moment that these men who aren't strong and brawny, these were fishermen. So let's suppose somehow they were able to force the stone away. Here's the question. These were the same disciples who less than 24 hours before were too fearful to even be at the place where he was crucified. So you mean to tell me in 24 hours they're going to get up all of this mighty valor, manship, and overpower some guards, move a stone when they weren't even willing to somehow they got up the courage to do what I said. They get the body and they hide it. We know, of course, that the Romans were looking for them. They get the body and they hide it. Well, what happens if you're hiding a dead man? You know he's dead. And you did this just to make an impression on others. And the Romans come knocking on your door. And they have in one hand the same cat of nine tails that you saw them whip Jesus with. What you would do. How long would you hold on to a lie? How long would you continue to stand against the Romans knowing that you know where the dead body is? I don't think that you would do it for very long. This, my brothers and sisters, is the reason that we can know that we know that we know.
Yes, yes.
Without a shadow of a doubt. That nobody helped him to come out of that tomb. Jesus rose. Just like he said he would. And if Jesus rose just like he said he would, then he is just who he says he was. And if he is who he says he was, why aren't you serving him? The day that you can no longer hide. The day that you can no longer say, oh, but I didn't know. It's a day that the tomb was found empty. I want to ask you to look with me at John chapter number 10. Verse 17 and 18. John chapter number 10, verse 17 and 18. Now, as you're standing, we have a custom, tradition, practice here at Seed of Faith of honoring the Word of God. So as you turn to John chapter 10, verse 17 and 18, I'm going to ask that you would please stand and just take your Bible. And if you don't have a Bible, there's one in most of the pews. There's one position there for you. And what we ask that you do as you stand, and we recite a pledge to this Bible, because this is the Word of God, and there's power in the Word of God. Amen. So I'm going to ask that you would all stand, all of you who are able. This is not in honor of me, but it's in honor of God our Father. And we're going to recite this pledge together. Would you lift your Bible up? And as we do our pledge, we will say it together. Let us begin now. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy Word. I will make it a lamp to my feet, a light to my path. I will hide his words in my heart, that I might not sin against God. Amen. From verse number 17 and 18, John chapter number 10. Jesus is speaking, and this is what he says. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. Amen. This morning I want to speak to you for a few moments on the subject, you can't keep Jesus down. You can't keep Jesus down. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We ask you now to inspire us, even as you enlighten us. Hide me behind your cross, dear Lord God. Use me as you see fit. We thank you for your glory. We thank you for your presence and for your spirit. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, you can't keep Jesus down. People have been trying for generations, a millennium, all the way back to this truth, to keep Jesus down. Now, I must admit, they gave it their best shot. But no matter what man may seek to do, people may endeavor to do, to silence the truth, you cannot keep Jesus down. Yes, they nailed him to the cross. They pierced him in the side. They ridiculed him, spat upon him, and whipped him to the flesh began to fall off of his back. But you can't keep Jesus down. I'm here to let you know today that not only can you not keep him down, but you can't keep him buried either. Many people today want to keep Jesus in a box.
Right.
Many people figuratively want to keep him in the tomb. Some want to keep Jesus in the past. Some want to keep Jesus out of their business. Some want to keep Jesus out of their life. I want to keep Jesus out of my stuff. I like him right where he is. Sunday morning, in church.
Facebook,
it has its downside because friends. And these friends are so close to you that if your birthday didn't pop up on their Facebook, they wouldn't even know what month you were. But yet, all of these interconnections, and yet we know less about each other than any time in the past. Now here's the good side of this social media. Because everything now is so transparent, you can throw a picture up, and before you know it, it's been liked by hundreds of people that you don't even know. You can't walk down in the community when you get certain information out there on Facebook and try to act like that ain't me. I know it was you. I got your picture right here on Facebook. Compartmentalizing your life to try to have a Sunday self and a Saturday self and acting like the two don't meet. You can't do today when your Saturday self is chug-a-lugging on Facebook. It's out there, you can never get it back. Let me just tell you, I'm not going to stay here long, but this is important. Even if you are looking for a job, these days, one of the first things your employer will do when you are applying for a job, you can send your resume if you want to, just go ahead and send it in. But the first thing they do before they even bring you in for an interview, they're going to do a Google search. They're going to check you out. And you can say, oh, I've got this and I've got that and I'm this and I'm that. And when you show up for that interview, they're going to be looking at you. Yeah, I saw you stopping and leaving. They're going to pull you up on Facebook, pull you up on Google. And for the youth, I need to tell you something.
Love you. Wake us up.
You need to be careful about what so-called friend you send a picture to. Were you not discreet? And where you're not covering yourself?
Yeah.
Where you just putting yourself out there because everybody is doing it. They call that sexting. I want you to know that there are some people right now who are in jail.
Love you, Pastor.
Because they got something from somebody and they put it out there and circulated it around. There are people right now who committed suicide. Women. Because somebody they thought was a Facebook friend took their business and put it all the way out there. What am I suggesting to you this morning? What I'm suggesting to you is that we don't live in an era.
Come on now.
Where you can keep things in a box. We don't live in an era where you can compartmentalize yourself. I got one self here and another self there. Now, if you can't do that in your personal life, what makes you think that the God who is called omniscient, who knows everything, the God who is called omnipotent, who has all power, the God who is omnipresent, who is everywhere at the same time, what in the world makes you think if you can't keep your friends out of your business? What makes you think you can keep God out of your business? We want to keep him in the tomb. Resurrection day tells me that I cannot keep the Lord buried any longer. We put up barricades and we put up barriers to try to prevent the truth from being revealed. Matthew chapter number 27, verse 64. The Word of God says in Matthew chapter number 27, verse number 64 through 66 says, sepulcher, that is the grave, be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away, and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead, so that the last error shall be worse than the first. These are the Romans talking. Put something out there so that he doesn't get out, so that they can't get in. Pilate said unto them, you have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can. So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. I want to let you know, when God gets ready, I don't care what kind of barricades you think you're trying to put to prevent him from moving in. I don't care what kind of obstacles you think you put in place to make sure that Jesus stays buried in the tomb. I want you to know the Romans did everything they could, but when God said it's time, he moved, and he moved the stone away. Second thing I need to tell you is that the Lord, you can't keep Jesus down. The second thing I tell you is that he is at work even in the dark. Jesus is at work even in the dark. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 45 and 46. When you look at this text, what you will see is this. 45 and 46. Now, from the sixth hour, there was darkness. You see that? Over all the land until the ninth hour. Now, their clock was different than our clock. Sixth hour was noontime. That's the sixth hour, noon. Where's the sun at noon? It's right up above you, isn't it? It don't get pitch black at noon unless God intervenes. Scripture says it went dark. It went pitch black from noon until 3 p.m. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? It was dark. He was alone. He was isolated.
Yes.
But he is at work, even in dark places. He went